Welcome to Understand the Math.
This video is part of a series of videos on linear algebra and its applications, and is an introduction to section 1.1, Systems of Linear Equations. We'll talk about systems of linear equations in general, and then dive into two examples so that you can see how systems of linear equations arise in applications. Be sure to check out the link below for free guided notes that you can use while you watch this video. There's space in the notes for you to highlight the concepts that we'll go over and fill out the answers to the examples that we're going to do. A linear equation is an equation that can be written in the form a1x1 plus a2x2 all the way up to anxn is equal to b. The variables are x1 all the way up through xn, and the coefficients are a1 all the way up to an, as well as b. Now let's look at a set of more than one linear equation. This set is called a system of linear equations, and it's a collection of two or more linear equations involving the same set of variables. A system of linear equations can be written like this, and this system has n variables, x1 through xn, and m equations. The coefficients are all the a's and all the b's. In section 1.1 and 1.2, we'll go over a systematic method for solving systems of linear equations just like this. Let's now look at two example problems so that we can see how systems of linear equations arise in applications. In our first example, a chemist has one solution that is 25% saline and another solution that is 15% saline. What we want to find is how many milliliters of each solution should they use to end up with 50 milliliters of a solution that is 20% saline. With this problem, we have one solution that is 25% saline and another one that is 15% saline, and they're going to be combined to make a solution that is 20% saline. And our job is to figure out how much of 25% saline and how much of 15% saline we should use. The first step that we want to do is to choose our variables. Let's let X be the amount in milliliters of 25% saline. We'll then let Y be the amount in milliliters of 15% saline. Our second step is to look for relationships between these two variables, X and Y, and find a linear system of two equations and two unknowns. The first equation that we're going to use involves total volume. Our solution is going to be made up of X plus Y, and it's going to equal 50 milliliters. Our second equation involves saline concentration, which is the percent saline times the amount. We're going to have 25% saline for our X amount, and then we're going to have 15% saline of our Y amount. 15% is 0.15, 25% is 0.25. And that is going to be equal to our final amount, which is going to be 20% saline, which is 0.20, times 50 milliliters. The right-hand side is equal to 10. Let's now simplify this equation by multiplying both sides by 100. This gives us 25x plus 15y is equal to 1,000. Let's go ahead and write that in our box. So our two equations are x plus y is equal to 50, and then 25x plus 15y is equal to 1,000. We're going to use substitution to solve it. So the first thing we're going to do is solve for y. So let's let y be 50 minus x, and we'll plug that value into our second equation. Doing this, we get 25x plus 15 times our new y, which is 50 minus x, and that's all equal to 1,000. I already filled in the rest of the steps to save us some time, and when we go through the algebra, multiply everything out, we end up with x is equal to 25. We then take that value and plug it back up into y, and we end up with a value of y is equal to 25. So the solution to this problem is that we're going to need to use 25 milliliters of 25% saline, and then 25 milliliters of 15% saline solution. This is just a nice example of where an application problem can be solved by solving a system of linear equations. There are other methods that we could have used to solve this problem. For example, we could have used graphing. One really nice graphing program that I often suggest to students to use is Desmos. It's free and it's really great. And all you would have to do is, let's go back up here. You would plug in these two equations and then graph it. And then the point of intersection of these two graphs would be the solution to the problem, which is 25 and 25. The other method that we could have used is an elimination algorithm. And that's where we're heading with this course. We're going to learn how to use elimination algorithms to solve system of equations just like this one. Let's now look at an example that has more equations. In this example, we have a network shown in the figure below here that involves the traffic flow in vehicles per hour over several one-way streets in downtown State College, that's in Pennsylvania, right where Penn State is, during a typical early afternoon. We have four intersections, and they're labeled A, B, C, and D. We're going to start solving this problem by writing equations that describe the traffic flow. At each intersection, what we're going to do is we're going to set the flow in equal to the flow out. Let's go ahead and do that, and we'll start with intersection A. That's often called node A. We have, from the left, 300 cars going in, and from the bottom, we have 500 cars going in, and that's going to equal the cars going out, x1 to the right, and then x2 up above. At intersection B, we have x2 plus x4 traveling into the intersection, and then we have 300 and x3, let's pull this down so you can see that, there's x3, traveling out of the intersection. I would suggest you stop the video and see if you can write down the equations for C and D. For C, we have 100 and 400 going in, and then we have x4 plus x5 going out, and at intersection D, we have x1 and x5 going in, and 150 and 450 going out. The second step that we're going to do is we're going to rewrite this linear system of equations to be in the same form that we had on the first page. Let's flip back real quick to look at that. Right here is what we want our linear system to look like. All the x's are on the left, and all the constants are on the right-hand side, and the x's are arranged from x1, and in our example, all the way up to x5. To save us some time, I've rewritten the equations. You can see that in our first equation, we have x1 and x2 on the left and 800 on the right. All we did was rearrange the terms from the equation for intersection A. We did the same thing for the other three equations. What I want to point out now is that we have four equations and five unknowns. That might be something different than you've ever encountered before. You've probably used to always having the same number of unknowns as equations. In lots of application problems, that's not going to be the case. your equations might not match up with your number of unknowns. You might have more unknowns than you have equations. We're going to jump to the solution on page 5 and see its structure, and then we'll return to page 4 and see how to actually obtain this solution. Since we have 5 variables and 4 equations, one of our variables is going to be what we call a parameter. We'll set that variable to be x5. And the solution for x1, x2, x3, and x4 will have x5 in it. If we look at our first equation, we can solve for x1 by moving x5 to the right-hand side. So we end up with a solution that looks like 600 minus x5. If we do that for the next equation, we get that x2 is 200 plus x5. Doing the same thing for the next two equations, we get x3 is 400. There's no x5 in x3. And x4 is equal to 500 minus x5. To better understand what's going on with x5, let's return to our traffic flow diagram just for a minute. Here's x5. So x5 represents the number of vehicles per hour that are going into intersection D. So x5 is a parameter, which means that we can choose what number it should be. Let's assume that x5 is equal to 300, and then let's see what the other variables are equal to. If we let x5 be 300, then looking at our answer here, we can see that x1 is going to be 600 minus 300, which is 300. x2 will be 500. x3 stays fixed at 400. And then x4 is going to be 500 minus 300, which is 200. This application problem is an example of where we have a linear system of equations that has infinitely many solutions. We'll often say that our parameter can take on values from minus infinity to infinity, but we often need to change that depending on the application problem. So for this one, we can say that x5 has to be greater than or equal to 0, because the number of vehicles has to be a number greater than or equal to 0. Let's now return to page 4 so that we can understand the general idea of how to actually get this solution. I've labeled our 4 equations as R1, R2, R3, and R4. That's to get us ready for when we're going to be using matrices to solve these types of problems, and we have rows of a matrix instead of equations. When we looked at the solution, we saw that we solved for x1, x2, x3, and x4 in terms of x5. Now we're going to see how to actually do that. We want to only have one equation that has an x1 term in it, and we're going to choose that equation to be our first equation. That means we have to eliminate the x1 from our fourth equation. To do that, we're going to do what's called a row replacement, and we'll talk about this in future videos. We're going to let row 4 become row 4 minus row 1, which means we're basically going to take equation 4 and we're going to subtract equation 1 from it. This is a new equation that we end up with. x1 minus x1 was 0. We picked up a minus x2, and then we have an x5, and then we picked up a minus 200, which came from 600 minus 800. Now we're going to do something similar with x2. We're going to choose that our second equation is the only one with an x2, and we're going to eliminate x2 from this equation and from this equation. To do that, we're going to take row 1 or equation 1 and make it row 1 minus row 2, and then likewise row 4 is going to be replaced with row 4 plus row 2. And you can see that the x2 from equation 1 and from equation 4 went away. We're going to do the same type thing to only get x3 in equation 3 and x4 in equation 4. In my next series of videos, we're going to go through this more slowly and get a lot more practice with this type of algorithm. As you can see from this last example, we need a systematic approach to solve systems of linear equations. The systematic approach that we're going to use in this series of videos is the Gauss-Jordan elimination algorithm. It's similar to what we just did for this example, but more structured. In the next video in this series, we'll dive into more of the details and terminology that we'll need to know in order to solve linear systems of equations.
If this video has been helpful to you, please consider subscribing to my channel. Keep believing in yourself and have a great rest of your day.